So on a Saturday, 15 years ago, I was falling in love with chemistry by blowing things up in my parents' suburban backyard. Now, on a Saturday like today, the greatest hazard that chemistry poses to me as a theorist probably comes from carpal tunnel. I get to use a wrist brace, though. It's okay. Chemistry is the study of chemical systems, how one or more things turns into something else. As chemists, we'd like to be able to understand, maybe control, or at least take advantage of these transformations. And you care a lot about how they happen if you're trying to synthesize a new drug, or if you're trying to understand how something like protein misfolding leads to something like Alzheimer's. Precise descriptions of how these reactions occur are called chemical reaction mechanisms, which are what I study. A chemical reaction mechanism tells us how, on an atomic level, what happens when one thing turns into something else. Now, for simple systems containing only a few molecules, we thought we'd seen it all. Well-established theories backed by ample experimental evidence gave us a tidy picture of what happens when a chemical reaction occurs. Now, formaldehyde, or embalming fluid, is one such simple system. It's made up of just four atoms, a carbon and an oxygen, and two hydrogens. And we knew that because formaldehyde is such a simple system, it makes a great case for the study of how light interacts with chemical reactions. In fact, it's such a good system that theoreticians and experimentalists alike have beaten it to death for the last 40 years. We knew that if you shone a particular color of light under formaldehyde, it would fall in half, turning into carbon monoxide and hydrogen gas. And we had a pretty good idea of how it happened. The hydrogens would wander around, eventually they would bump into each other and head off on their way. Now, that's nice, but a decade ago, scientists noticed formaldehyde do something they'd never before seen or imagined anything to do. Instead of just falling apart the way we expected it would, something strange happened. Instead of the hydrogen popped off and did a full orbit around the molecule before coming back through and falling off with its partner. This is really strange. In fact, it's so weird that it left a lot of people really puzzled about it. This is like driving from Providence to Boston, but taking a pit stop in Chicago. Really. It was so weird that people said, oh, it's an isolated oddity. This doesn't really happen very much. It turns out they were wrong. Roaming happens in all kinds of systems and represents a totally new class of chemical reaction mechanisms. And 10 years out, we don't really have a good understanding of why it's happening or how to explain it. And that's where Rich and I come in, my advisor. Nature's strange experimental results are nature's invitation to new ways of looking at the world and at a problem. For roaming, we're using a strange new lens to try and come up with a way to give us insight and unlock this riddle that we have before us. Here's the idea. One of the ways that you can consider chemical reactions is by imagining a landscape, or with a map for it. The landscape has mountain passes and peaks and plateaus and other things, and these features determine how the system evolves in time. Once we have such a map, which we can create for formaldehyde using something like quantum chemical calculations, we can ask the map questions. One of the questions we might ask is, what's the mechanism? We want to understand how roaming works. Finding the mechanism is as simple as saying, okay, here's the reactants area, here's the products area. I want to get between the two of them. If we find the route, then we found the mechanism. For formaldehyde, this problem is akin to choosing the route from an infinity of options between two cities separated by a wide range of mountains. Now, it is possible, using molecular dynamics, to find such a path for formaldehyde. Unfortunately, when we do, the paths are tangled like a bird's nest of wires. They go all over the place, and we can't really see what's going on. Now, what we really want, somehow, is a filtered version of this path. We want something to show us the well-worn and well-traveled paths of the map, to show us what the true mechanism behind roaming is. So our idea is this. We say, okay, we'll look for the shortest paths, or the optimal paths on this map. Maybe once we find those, that'll work out. Some of our previous research suggested that these paths might be the filtered version we were looking for, the routes without all the tangles. For the last year, my work has been to look for these particular routes, and then to understand what makes them special. In this first part, I've had great success. I've managed to write a program that can start in the reactants area, make it to the products area of formaldehyde, and we know that it's short, or we hope that it's short at any rate. But when we look at the paths, we see that they're smooth and clear. They're free of tangles, which means this filter is working. That's really great and new all on its own. But the next step is to figure out what makes these paths special. Perhaps there's a particular mountain pass or valley overlook that they all go by. I'm not sure what I will find, or even if there is anything to be found, But that's the excitement of science, and I'm excited to wade in. Thank you very much.